The Philippines is expected to lose billions of pesos in tourism receipts in the wake of the coronavirus pandemic. Travel restrictions caused booking cancellations at hotels and resorts, and local authorities believe that the health crisis could prove to be catastrophic for small tourism enterprises if it extends for a few more months. Tourism Undersecretary Benito Bengzon Jr. now joins us live to tell us how the local industry is coping and what it plans to do to revive the tourism industry after the pandemic. Good morning, Mr. Undersecretary, and thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Good morning, Christian, and thank you for having me in the program.
Okay, first, let's talk about the impact so far of this ongoing lockdown of the COVID-19 pandemic in the local tourism industry.
Well, not surprisingly, tourism has really taken a hit because of the pandemic crisis. And by our estimates, for the first 3 months of this year, the number of foreign visitors coming to the Philippines has already gone down by about 35%. And in terms of revenue, more or less we're looking at the same range, about minus 35% reduction. So you can just imagine the impact that it has had, not only on the headcount, but more importantly on revenue and, of course, on employment, because a lot of workers in various tourism-related enterprises have been affected. Some of them have been displaced and some of them have been terminated.
In peso terms, how much are we talking about here in terms of foregone revenues, for example?
Well, initially we were looking at, for the first 3 months of the pandemic, we were looking at approximately 39 billion pesos. But we have yet to finalize, to firm up the figures. The figures will have to be based on the final count of foreign visitor arrivals, which we haven't finalized yet.
And so far, what kind of assistance has been provided, for example, to members of, let's say, to the stakeholders in the tourism industry?
Well, over the past few weeks, we've had a series of consultations with our stakeholders in the tourism industry. And the instruction of Secretary Bernard Romulo Puyat is to immediately put together a tourism response and recovery program, which will serve as the roadmap for the tourism industry in the next couple of years. We've divided the program into two phases, the response period and the recovery period. So for the response, what we've done is we've assisted foreign and domestic travelers who have been stranded in many parts of the country. We've also been helping the Department of Health and OWA in looking for accommodations for our returning Filipinos. But directly for, you know, as far as assistance to the tourism stakeholders, we have waived all fees that we would normally charge, you know, whether it's in terms of accreditation or participation fees in international fairs. We have also identified low-interest loan facilities that the partners from the private sector might avail of. And we've also made representations with other government agencies, either for the, well, basically for the deferment of payments of contributions, PhilHealth, SSS, and other agencies.
How about the, let's say, the ordinary workers in the tourism industry? Is there a specific, let's say, aid coming from the Department of Tourism, or they are already covered in the direct cash transfer program, for example, of the DSWD?
Well, up until April 15, we assisted the tourism enterprises in applying for cash assistance, no, for their workers under the CAMP and TUPAD programs of the DOLE. Of course, there's now a new program under the Department of Finance, the Small Business Wage Subsidy, which will also be another platform for workers in the tourism industry, the displaced workers, to get some cash assistance. But prospectively, we're also working on, well, a more consolidated approach to make sure that there is business continuity, because after the, if and when the ECQ is lifted during the post-COVID stage, it's very important for us to provide assistance to the tourism enterprises. We have to get them back on their feet again, so that at the right time we can resume our marketing and promotions activities.
What is the time frame of the pandemic that was considered when the DOT was crafting its response and recovery program? How many months were you looking at?
It's really difficult to determine when the starting point will be, but for purposes of the initial coming up with an initial time frame for the tourism response and recovery program, we're looking at the response period until end of June of this year, and what we refer to as the recoil period or the transition period from July all the way to December of 2020. By and large, the recovery initiatives will start the first quarter of 2021, and most of the programs that we've outlined will be implemented all the way to the end of 2022. So essentially, that's a time frame that we've identified. But again, I emphasize the need to help tourism enterprises get back on their feet, give them access to low interest loans, so that we can address this particular concern of business continuity.
Mm-mm. Now, of course, there's talk of possibly extending the enhanced community quarantine, if not for the entire Luzon island, but in select areas where there are still a high number of COVID-19 cases. This has been considered in the planning of the DOT for the industry. For example,
yes,
there's talk of extending it for, let's say, until May 15.
Yes, well, even with the extension, the instruction of the secretary is to start looking at training programs, online training programs that we can offer to our tourism stakeholders. And again, the idea here is to make sure that the level of preparedness is still there. So last week, for example, we had an online seminar that talked about preparing for a post-COVID-19 scenario. We also had a seminar on Filipino values. Just the other day, we had a seminar on the MICE industry, meetings, incentives, conventions, and exhibitions. So we will see a lot more webinars being spearheaded by the Department of Tourism, the Tourism Promotions Board, with the objective of making sure that the stakeholders are ready when we resume operations.
Mm. Now, for example, if the Department of Tourism would be asked, for example, what would be your recommendation when it comes to, let's say, relaxing quarantine measures in certain areas, in certain areas with the tourist destinations, where there are not exactly that many, or where the, for example, the pandemic or the outbreak has been put under control? Would you consider, for example, relaxing the rules there, for example?
We will have to defer to the Department of Health and the Department of Interior and Local Government because they know the situation on the ground better. But from a macro point of view, it's really important that we have an integrated approach to tourism marketing and promotions. Bear in mind that when a tourist enters Manila, Manila is not the final, it's not the only destination. From our research, we've seen that tourists prefer to do multiple destinations. So that being the case, it is important that if at all ECQ is lifted in Manila, the ideal is for the ECQ to be lifted also in the other destinations, which are expected to host or to welcome foreign, not only foreign visitors, but even local tourists.
Mm-hmm. Well, for example, this is also part of the options. Relaxing rules when it comes to relaxing quarantine measures or restrictions when it comes to domestic tourism, just to make sure that things will get going in the meantime while the rest of the country is still dealing with this pandemic.
Well, we say that we will have to defer to the local government units, but on the part of the DOT, what is important is that we start developing the new normal protocols or procedures, which will help travelers in the post-COVID phase. So when I talk about new normals, we'll have to start coming up with guidelines, for example, on tour operations. Now, people are now talking about, instead of filling up a 40-seater bus with 40 passengers, maybe we'll just limit it to 50% capacity. People are now talking about making a mandatory distribution of face masks and sanitizers. Even the hotels are coming up with their plans to redesign or reconfigure some of their facilities, no, to make sure that we meet or we address the changing expectations, changing behaviors of consumers post-COVID. So these are the new normals that we will have to address, and the dialogues and conversations with the private sector continue as we aim to come up with a long list of these new protocols.
But so far, those are the options that might be included, of course, logically, in the protocols under a new normal, which is, of course, a situation that is here to stay, given the pandemic that we are dealing with now.
Well, that's correct. You know, people in the tourism industry are unanimous in saying that the protocols will definitely be different, and this will cut across the different sectors in the tourism value chain. So earlier I mentioned about the interventions in the hotel sector, but even the airlines are coming up with their own proposed measures to address the new normal. So for example, we will probably see more self-check-in, possibility of self baggage tagging, less interaction with airline personnel. So the crafting of the new normal is something that you will see across the different sectors of the tourism industry.
When are you expected to complete this this protocol, the list?
Well, we are halfway through the drafting of the Tourism Response and Recovery Program, and the protocols that I've mentioned will all be incorporated in this master document. So we're hoping to consolidate the new normal protocols and procedures in the next 2 weeks. But even, you know, as we speak, we have a substantial list already of the proposed measures coming from our stakeholders in tourism.
And of course, those changes would also entail more expenses. For example, you mentioned physical distancing in buses, for example. You need to put in more buses, for example, to accommodate more tourists in one particular area. So these things have also been considered in the planning.
Yes, well, you're absolutely correct. This will have cost implications. And again, the partners, our partners in tourism are well aware of this. There will be an increase in the cost components. But again, this is something that we have to do because the situation is different. But I think what the industry is also one in saying that it is important that we see a level of cooperation that we've never witnessed before, because definitely the challenges will be there. And if the industry is to move forward, it would need cooperation for the stakeholders. Right now, many are saying that recovery will probably be, well, let me put it this way. Some people are saying that we will not be able to go back to the 2019 levels until 2021 at the earliest, or maybe even 2022. So the challenge that we have at hand is to accelerate the recovery, and the way to do it is to make sure that we get the cooperation of all the stakeholders.
Finally, will there be a change, or will you tweak, for example, the approach when it comes to marketing the Philippines in a post-pandemic scenario? You mentioned the recall period of 2021. Will you also tweak that particular approach?
There will be changes, definitely, in the overall marketing and promotions approach. People will start to look for low density but high value kind of experience. They will stay away from crowded places. We also expect that the visitors will be looking for more product-oriented experience as opposed to just a destination. The decision making will also change. People will not really be looking at the lowest package available. More important than that is the flexibility. So in the initial survey that we conducted, it actually ranked number one, flexibility in travel arrangements as a major factor in deciding to travel. So the answer to your question is yes, there will be adjustments in our marketing and promotions. And even in the product development side, we will see some adjustments as well.
Now, do you see this also as a challenge? Because the Philippines ranks in Southeast Asia as among the countries with the highest number of COVID-19 cases. And of course, in a post-pandemic scenario, again, we'll be competing with the top dogs in the region when it comes to luring tourists from elsewhere, for example. Will that be a challenge, the fact that we are registering one of the most or the highest numbers of COVID cases in Southeast Asia?
We don't really consider it as a major challenge. We feel that our health authorities have been able to address the situation quite well. One advantage the Philippines has is that because we are an archipelago, there are far more options to offer to tourists, and I think it's going to be easier also to monitor the movements of our visitors here in the country, being an island nation.
Okay, Undersecretary Benito Bengzon Jr., thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you, Christian.